Hello and welcome to Newswire. I'm Jawad Tehami. With every single passing day, COVID-19 is affecting countries more across the globe. As of today, the fatalities have risen closer to 70,000 and over 1.3 million people are infected with the deadly virus. So on one hand, where the pandemic has overwhelmed the healthcare systems of the developed countries, it has opened up a twofold challenge for the developing countries. Pakistan has not been an exception. Although there hasn't been a dramatic rise in infections and casualties, yet the country has imposed conditional lockdowns to contain the spread of the virus. So far, over 3,000 cases have been registered with 50 deaths and 257 recoveries. To check the viral spread, the government has established a command and operation center and has announced programs to mitigate the economic fallout of the pandemic. Prime Minister Imran Khan has said that the government is trying to maintain a balance between continuing the ongoing lockdown and minimizing the unemployment so that the economy doesn't collapse and people don't die of hunger. The Pakistan Army is also assisting the government by rolling out all-out resources to combat the crisis. And to talk more about this and what the steps the government is taking to combat the pandemic as well as keep the economy running, we are joined today at Newswire by Mr. Naseem Beg, economist, joining us from Karachi, and Dr. Javed Hayat Khan, his consultant pulmonologist, joining us from Lahore. Thank you both of you gentlemen for joining at Newswire today. I just want to go into the details of both the things separately, the threat of the disease and its spread and the damage, and the kind of steps the government is actually taking to run, to keep the economy running. I'll start the discussion with you, Mr. Beg. How do you see, although when we saw the first case was registered in Pakistan, there was a little bit of slow response, but yet it was timely response by the government. Is that correct?
I think the government has acted quickly enough, given the fact that it is something that is new to the entire world. And if you look around, the far more developed countries have been struggling. So I would say that our government has done the right things. And I would add that when we talk of our government, we should really be talking of our provincial governments as well. And I think some of them have been far more proactive. Others started following. The federal government, of course, has also got its actions right. A lot more perhaps needs to be done. But as a starting point, I think we can feel good about Pakistan being an underdeveloped country for being proactive enough and taking some major measures to try and mitigate the problem.
Okay, I'll take this very to Dr. Khan. Dr. Khan, do you think the steps which have been taken by the government, not only at the federal level, but at the provincial level as well, are they sufficient enough to contain the spread and the damage of this particular virus?
I think this question in a different context. The government, as far as I'm aware of from the first-hand information, since January, they have been preparing to meet the challenges which we would be facing at that point. Remember, this virus came in December 2019. So in a way, we did have some time to prepare ourselves. The government at provincial level, as well as federal level, they have prepared certain guidelines, and they have done the courses and the awareness programs and the very clear roadmap of what to do and when to do. And till today, there have been regular meetings and follow-up and monitoring system is in place. We are fortunate enough so far that the way we were initially, we were fearing that there may be explosion of the disease. It has not happened so far. But again, we are not, I think we are still underestimating the disease which we will be having. So just to reiterate, yes, government take the steps. There's always a room to improve, and they are meeting the challenge at present.
So Dr. Khan, you're of the view that we have been fortunate till now that the disease hasn't spread on such a larger scale in Pakistan as compared to its spread in countries like Iran, the US, Italy, and Spain. What exactly do you think that kept the number of the infections in Pakistan at a lower level?
You may be hearing a lot of observations. One of the observations, rather two observations, which are being circulated among the healthcare professionals, is that something to do with the malaria region. If you see the most of the disease which has spread is not malaria region. And secondly, the BCG vaccination. There are a lot of the reports coming in that maybe the BCG vaccination, which we are giving at birth in our country as well as in other countries around in the subcontinent, that may have provided some indirect protection to the virus. But they are just the theories and observations. We cannot say, and definitely this is the case. The second part, which we should not ignore, we are not doing mass screening for all patients. We are just doing a targeted screening with a PCR. We don't have the resources, we don't have the abilities, and we don't have the system to cope with it. We do mass screening as China did. They just isolated the whole population and checked everybody. So I think so far, disease we have not detected as much as, so maybe it's real, maybe it's not real. It's difficult to say.
Okay. Mr. Baig, what do you think? What was that exact first measure that the government actually took that helped in order to contain the spread of the disease in the country?
Well, two things. Looking around the world, and even those countries which thought that lockdowns weren't necessary, which includes the UK and the US, or they thought that they'd go slow on it, I think everyone started realizing that at an initial stage, a complete lockdown is essential to arrest the spread of the disease. Yes, we've done the right thing of a lockdown. We've perhaps not enforced it in the manner that, say, China was able to. But nevertheless, coming to the economic fallout, very clearly, whether you're running a factory or a small business or whatever your business, if you stop running it overnight, you will have serious cash flow problems. If you have inventories on order, your raw materials on order, they will start piling up. Your sales are not there. Your receivables don't come in. And yet you want to pay the people you employ. So you run into significant cash flow problems. While the government and the central bank have come out with measures that would mitigate some of this, the pure liquidity, I mean, like when we say that the state bank has said that you can pay your loans later, yet you have to pay your interest right now, there are not going to be deferrals on that. Some of the taxes that you have to pay might get deferred, but those are not issues that, or once you have cash generated, then whether or not you pay interest or whether or not you pay your taxes, it comes into play. But if you're not going to have any revenues come in, you will be short on cash. And that, to my mind, has not been addressed as yet. More so because a large bulk of our economy is the undocumented sector. And the undocumented sector is neither involved in the formal taxation issues nor in the banking channels. While if their businesses stop, they will have serious cash flow problems to keep themselves going, to keep paying their employees, etc. So there's a serious issue there. The other side is the agricultural side, which we have to recognize. I would imagine the countryside does not have a lockdown the way we have it in cities.
Mr. Bain, that is exactly what the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Imran Khan, also pointed out, that the agricultural sector was already open and it would be kept open. Alongside, the construction sector has also been opened. I'll come to this particular point. For now, I want to go to Dr. Khan. Dr. Khan, do you think that the people in Pakistan understand the severity of the situation? As of today, when we speak, there are over 3,000 cases registered in Pakistan, with 50 casualties, and on the other side, 257 people have recovered. Mr. Asad Umar has said that the lockdowns have actually helped a lot in containing the spread of the virus. Do you think the people at the grassroots level have that very understanding of the severity, that they should keep themselves in the quarantine and observe the lockdowns vigorously so that they don't become a facilitator in spreading the disease on a larger scale?
I think it's a very good question. Let's put it in this way. If you look at the two models, what happened in China, what happened in Europe, Chinese lockdown, 100% lockdown, everything, nothing moved. That's the way they did the lockdown. We have half-hearted mayors. I mean, still you find a lot of people on the roads. Still the business is open. And then we have the European model. And the European model, they just let it go, and eventually the disease went out of hand. We had a meeting with a Chinese delegation just looking at their experiences. They strongly believe in that they should have a very, very strict measures to control the disease. Our people are underestimating the disease, how contagious it is, and how dangerous it could be. Well, yes, there may be some effect of partial lockdown. Maybe, in my own opinion, the lockdown should have been much more severe than what we are experiencing at the moment. But having said that, there is a much more important part is the economic aspect of that, which we have to balance in our country. As pointed out by Ms. Wei, you have so many industries, your revenue is now affected. So I think that part is also equally important, as is that we have to control the disease spread.
You've just mentioned that the Chinese had the strict quarantines. That's why they were able to contain the spread of the disease timely. And you are of the view that Pakistan should have taken stricter measures and put in stricter lockdowns. So when we talk about China, there was a certain specific city, and the disease starting spreading from Wuhan to the rest of the areas in Hubei province. Chinese actually quarantined that province, not whole of China. Do you think there are certain clusters or pockets within Pakistan which should have been quarantined, or should the quarantine as it is today, which is conditional, which is not stricter, should have been implemented as it is around the country?
If we look at our case, where they originated from, we have two big pockets. One is the desiring coming from Iran. Rather three pockets, and three, what we have, the influx of people coming from the affected area, especially the Europe. And then thirdly, there were some local the gatherings, the religious gathering, here we got most of the cases. So these are the three major parts. Then we did identify within the regions, for example, I'm talking about Lahore, they have some hot spots, so that this is the area where they have most of the cases that come through. So there was a lot of discussion, if you just take them out, just isolate those areas, maybe you could be able to contain the disease. So there is a one school of thought on that. Just do the partial lockdown. Just keep an eye on those areas which are hot belts, and then maybe we could be able to control the disease. So I think it's just a different kind of methods you have to contain this contagious disease. That's what's happening at the moment.
Okay. Dr. Khan, I'll come back to you. I'll go to Mr. Baig for now. I asked a question to Dr. Khan, whether the people at the grassroots level understand the severity of the situation in terms that it can affect them as well as their loved ones, and there could be a facilitator in carrying and spreading the disease. So I just want to ask you whether the people have the understanding at the grassroots level, because these lockdowns, which are turning out to be a little detrimental for the grassroots level economy as well. So do the people understand the severity, and are they ready to sacrifice for a short span of time to let this happen in form of the lockdowns?
The economic sacrifice, I don't think people should have to make. I think that is where the governments, the provincial as the federal, as well as the federal government, have to make sure that people get their basics. And if you can keep getting your basics wherever you are in a lockdown situation, you will support the government, you will understand it. It's only when you are forced to go out because you are desperately hungry that you would break sort of requirement of that sort. So I think it's not a matter of sacrifice.
Mr. Baig, you think that it's people who have to sacrifice that much because the governments have to ensure. That's where particularly the federal government has said that that you've already mentioned that the agricultural sector was already open, and now the government has decided with a lesser burden of taxes to keep the construction sector open. So do you think that will work out for the larger interest of the common man at the grassroots levels, especially the daily wages and the labor class?
Okay, first of all, let me touch on agriculture. We are going into, in Sindh already, the wheat harvest season. And as we move to north over the next few months, the harvest season, there is no choice but to harvest our wheat. So it's not for the common man, it's for the entire nation that you need your wheat. Then they have to sow the new crop. So there is no choice out there. But that activity does not require people coming too close together. They can keep their distances, and with a fair amount of say messages through television, etc., on how to keep themselves protected would be important. More importantly, and I think we have to learn this from the Japanese, where they've been wearing masks for years. But the reason they wore masks was so that as a person, I don't go and infect someone else, not the other way around, that I'm wearing a mask to protect myself. So the thing that needs to be instilled in everyone's minds, and this has to be large scale propaganda through television, etc., messaging, that you have to make sure you don't infect others. So coming to agriculture, there's no choice but to have that activity. As regards the construction activity, while the sort of new package has been announced by the Prime Minister, it's not going to translate into construction activity overnight. It'll take.
Okay, Mr. Baig, thank you very much for the part of Newswire today. Economist joining us from Karachi talked at length how the government initiatives are going to help the people, especially at the grassroots levels. And he particularly shed light on the agricultural sector, that how it basically is going to help. Very briefly, Dr. Khan, as Mr. Baig was already mentioning, that there is going to be harvesting, wheat harvesting now, then there is going to be sowing of the new crop. Is there any study regarding the change of the impact of this particular virus when the weather changes?
There's no studies, just some of people are thinking maybe when the temperature changes, when it rises up, to maybe disease may become under control. Let me say one word, if you allow me. Mr. Baig very rightly said it's our responsibility as a social responsibility to make sure that we do not infect others. I think this is the bottom line of the whole campaign, that we are not just protecting ourselves, but we're making sure that we do not infect somebody else. So anybody who is sick, who has any symptoms, is really strongly urged, he should not be going out of the house at all. Not even wearing a mask, he should stay inside the house.
Mr. Nazim Baig, economist, joining us from Karachi. Thank you very much for your time at Newswire. And Dr. Javed Hayat Khan, a consultant, a pulmonologist, Punjab Kidney and Liver Institute, joining us from Lahore. Thank you very much for your time, both of you. With this, we come to the end of the first segment of Newswire. We'll take a short break, and when we return, we'll discuss the threat of ISIS in Afghanistan amid the political deadlock and uncertainty of intra-Afghan talks. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Newswire. I'm Jawad Tehami. On 25th of March in Afghanistan's capital, Kabul, 25 Sikh worshippers were killed by gunmen and suicide bombers at a Gurdwara. ISIS Khorasan later claimed the responsibility of the attack. Yesterday, The Afghan government claimed to have arrested ISIS Khorasan leader Aslam Farooqi. The National Directorate of the Security said 19 of Farooqi's associates were also arrested from Kandahar. As the Afghan government and the Taliban struggled to start the inter-Afghan talks owing to the delay in the prisoners' release and the political deadlock between President Ashraf Ghani and his rival Abdullah Abdullah, how serious is the threat of ISIS in the country? To talk more about this, we are joined today at Newswire by Mr. Masood Rani, analyst joining us from Kabul, and Mr. Ahmed Murid Apartar, former representative of the U.S. Central Command from Florida. Gentlemen, thank you for your time at Newswire. I'll start the discussion with you, Mr. Rahimi. How big is the ISIS threat in Afghanistan at this particular crucial time when the Afghan government and the Taliban are heading towards prisoner release and the start of the inter-Afghan talks?
Yes, so the government of Afghanistan arrested Mr. Aslam Farooqi from then the district of Kandahar province by 19 their militants from Kandahar province by the Afghan National Security Agency of Afghanistan. Mr. Farooqi is one of the leaders from ISIS. That he followed after 1 year of attack of ISIS in Iraq and Syria. They climbed in here in Afghanistan as a ISIS leader, as a top person section. So as we follow the media and news, also we have proof in papers from the side of ISIS have activity in Afghanistan. Mr. Farooqi is the Islamic State of Khorasan's leader. He is claimed the responsibility of the for the latest bloody attack in Kabul, and so he takes responsibility of many attacks in Afghanistan. So Afghanistan is happy to arrest such a dangerous commander or leader of ISIS in Afghanistan.
Okay, Mr. Padar, how strong do you think is the ISIS in Afghanistan, and what are those specific areas they have their strong presence in?
Sure. Let me first wish you safety and good health in this very difficult time because of the spread of the coronavirus to you and your esteemed colleagues.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
To answer your question,
I wish you the same.
To answer your question, I think ISIS threat is real and serious for Afghanistan, especially in the wake of the U.S.-Taliban agreement. As you are aware, the Taliban have, of course, suspended all their major attacks against U.S. forces and coalition forces. So it means that U.S. and coalition forces in Afghanistan are stepping up their operations against ISIS in Afghanistan. But on the other hand, ISIS has been conducting a string of attacks in urban areas such as Kabul, and the most recent one in a Sikh temple in Kabul, which was conducted on March 25th, as you mentioned. So ISIS threat remains very, very serious for Afghanistan. And not only in urban areas, but also in some rural areas too. And ISIS is mostly right now predominantly focused in eastern Afghanistan, still Konar and Nangarhar regions along the border.
So, okay, you view that ISIS remains a threat for the Afghan peace. So how much strength do you think they have in these particular areas, the Kunar province and Kandahar province that you have mentioned? We already know that they had stronghold in Nangarhar, but now the leader and his 19 accomplices have been arrested from Kandahar. It depicts that they have their presence or they are scattered all over the country.
That's true, yes. This recent arrest shows that they are scattered all over the country, as you mentioned. But they are mostly active, and they have been pretty much mostly active in eastern Afghanistan. That's where they emerged from in 2014 and 2015. But the good news is that since 2018, which they lost another leader as a result of air strikes by the United States. The organization of ISIS Khorasan, Islamic State for Afghanistan and Pakistan region, has been very weakened. Has been pretty much weakened. So although we see some sustained attacks from the group, but organizationally speaking, they have been weakened as a result of sustained air strikes by U.S. forces, Afghan security operations in different regions, and coordination between the Afghan and
Mr. Patel, you think that the strength of ISIS in Afghanistan in terms of organization and launching very organized attacks has reduced in last couple of years. How devastating is this particular arrest for the ISIS Khorasan as Asam Faruqi has been arrested?
This is a major blow for the organization, as I mentioned. This is a major blow, no doubt about it, especially that he has been captured with 19 other ISIS leaders. So this is a major blow, and I'm sure it will have a major impact on their operations, specifically on urban areas. And it's also said that he was personally involved on this Sikh temple attacks, which was carried out by the group on March 25th. So these arrests are very important and will have a major blow on the organization.
Okay, Mr. Pardar, how do you the U.S. providing support to the Taliban in its fight in Afghanistan? Already we have seen the head of the U.S. Central Command, General Frank McKenzie, said that the U.S. is providing the Taliban a limited yet a support in order to combat ISIS threat in the country.
I don't think that the U.S. will provide any support to the Taliban in order to fight ISIS in Afghanistan. But there has been some agreement, principle agreement between the U.S. and Taliban that the Taliban will act against ISIS forces under their areas. Those areas which are under their control, the Taliban will act and fight ISIS in this case. But as far as support is concerned, I don't think that the United States will provide any financial or logistical support to the Taliban in order to fight ISIS.
Mr. Pattar, U.S. Central Commander had General Frank McKenzie told lawmakers in a testimony before the House Armed Services Committee that the U.S. had provided the Taliban with support in order to combat ISIS. And he also admitted that the Taliban had crushed ISIS in Nangarhar.
The Taliban did fight the group in Nangarhar, and it's not new, actually. It started when the organization began in 2015, so it has a long history. I heard General McKenzie saying that the U.S. is coordinating, at least right now. As you are aware, they just concluded an agreement, so I think there is coordination to some extent. Especially now that the U.S. has shifted its focus from the Taliban to ISIS and Al-Qaeda cells in Afghanistan. So I think we will be witnessing in the future more coordination between the U.S. and Taliban on the fight against ISIS and as well as Al-Qaeda and other foreign terrorist groups in Afghanistan.
Okay, Mr. Pardar, do you think there might be more coordination between the U.S. and the Taliban? Do you think after the signing of the historic peace deal between the U.S. and the Taliban, now the Taliban are actually keeping up their promises of their efforts against counterterrorism in the country?
I think in very limited and specific regions, because, again, the U.S. has trained, you know, a very potent and capable national security forces, especially the Afghan commandos, who are able to crush these organizations, no doubt, and they are fighting against these organizations on a daily basis. So on specific regions, on specific areas that it's difficult to operate from the either U.S. side or Afghan security side, this, there may be or there will be potentially more agreement between the U.S. and Taliban on fighting not only ISIS, as I mentioned, but also against other foreign terrorist entities such as Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and other organizations.
Mr. Rahimi, I'll come to you. Why don't you think at this particular crucial time when the Afghan authorities, the Afghan government, and the Taliban are heading towards the peace process, but there is a delay, and that is exactly giving that vacuum is giving some room to the groups like ISIS to, you know, get more stronghold in the country?
The problem is the politics issue between Mr. Ghani and Abdullah. So also President Ghani was advertised and planned that I will release 5,000 militants of the Taliban group. So it takes delay the time, but hopefully as a push of the USA to start into the government of Afghanistan for release of 5,000 army of Taliban, that they become appointed on the, they fix the time for starting dialogue between Afghan government and Taliban. Right now, government of Afghanistan is busy too much with the elections problems that they have passed with that and politics issue. So they are working on the side of Taliban dialogue. Maybe in a few days soon, we can finish these problems. A 3 person come right now from Doha for control their military. They are belong to the Taliban group. These 3 person, I have their names, or it's secret, but we have all the information. So they are coming right now for discussions and control everything. Maybe President Ghani will become angry to release 5,000 army, but if they get, they receive the guarantee that after they go in the war, after they release, they're not going in the war. So as I heard yesterday, Mr. Shahin, this spokesman of the Taliban, claimed that our armies, when they release from the prison of Afghanistan, they never go back on the war. So it needs grant. The government of Afghanistan really wants grant.
Okay. Mr. Pattar, do you think there should be a realization on the part of the Taliban and the Afghan government that they should expedite the peace process and should actually start the inter-Afghan talks for a permanent settlement in the country so that the groups like ISIS don't happen to be a big threat in the country for the peace?
Absolutely. It's very important. It's very crucial, especially at this juncture. But unfortunately, right now, Afghanistan is a political crisis, as you are aware. So we have to resolve the current political deadlock before we start the peace and reconciliation process with the Taliban. The political crisis is, again, as a result of the election that President Ghani was announced as the winner, but Abdullah, one of the major contenders, he's it does not recognize those that announcements by the election commission due to the fraud in the election. And as a result, we witnessed 2 presidents actually simultaneously, Mr. Ghani and Mr. Abdullah, taking swearing oath ceremonies in Kabul on March 9th.
So, Mr. Pattar, you think that this particular thing remains the major intent in the Afghan political permanent settlement of in the country, and it basically is hindering the Afghan peace process, as Abdullah has claimed himself the president of the country, and on the other side, there is another president. So being there 2 presidents in a country is a big issue which should be resolved. Mr. Masood Rahimi, analyst and politician and peace ambassador, joining us from Kabul. Thank you very much. And Mr. Ahmed Murid Pattar, former representative of the U.S. Central Command, joining us from Florida. Thank you very much for your time, both of you gentlemen. And with this, we come to the end of today's Newswire. We'll be back with some more in-depth analysis on major happenings from around the world tomorrow. Till then, it's goodbye.